morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I want to call your attention one or two things about the bulletin. So if you want to confuse, we'll get to that point. First of all, you'll notice there's a mystery in that there are two prayers of confession. Now, things are rough for all of us right now, but we really have to need two prayers of confession. So that we will read the first one, pray the first one, and then go immediately to the first again. The second thing you'll notice is that Pastor Jeff is not here. Sometime last Monday evening or Tuesday morning, he came in contact with people who were in contact with people who were in contact with someone who had virus. And so rather than risk unnecessary exposure, he is sort of quarantining himself to take the test to come back from the original therapy. Kim Foster will be reading the sermon that Pastor Riverdale provided for us, as well as the contributors. Right. We thank you, Kim. Please stand if you are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgive all our sins, whose mercy endures forever.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. Gracious God,
have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace, we have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, our sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen us with the power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in our hearts through faith.
Amen.
Thank you.
God, from which nothing can separate us, and the life-giving Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
On the fifth Sunday at Pentecost, welcome to this service of worship. Now and then, we all see people out walking, and sometimes they have ankles and weights or fractures. Weights and ankles. Wrists and weights on their ankles. I have a set of my own. The weights, we're told, intensify the workout to help improve a heart rate. It's a good image. Pretty much of what we're reading today and what the focus of this worship service is. because we all are weighed down with bitterness and all such other things, guilt and shame. This, however, at least how we don't help our hearts. If we really want to help our hearts, if we really want to have strong and healthy hearts and spirits, then the best thing we can do is to accept Jesus' invitation, come unto him, and set down the weight of our life to be refreshed and redeemed. As we gather for communion this day, let us do just that. Let us come to him and be refreshed. And let us lift up our hearts and minds and worship and praise the Lord this day. I don't think we have visitors today, but if we do, would you welcome them again, practicing the church practices that we have all come to know and to love. By way of announcements, we would just remind you that Calvary Refuge still needs to be, and you can contact Jeremiah about the location for a camp before the evening, so we can reward some of the people. The Wednesday evening communion service is still not being held, it's being postponed, but we do have a Wednesday evening prayer and check-in service, and you're invited to participate there by way of Zoom. An email goes out each Tuesday evening or Wednesday morning, giving you contact information for the service at the half hour long. And it will give you the opportunity to check in for the government. Our Facebook Samaritans will continue to need our food. And as usual, you may bring those food items that you need to use for your future and we will be we can still say that no member of the church has contracted or has contracted the COVID-19 virus. So we continue to give thanks for that, but at the same time, we do remember the large number of people who have become people who see the social media. We want to introduce you now to the lessons for today. They are the lessons from Zechariah, from Romans, and from Matthew. The first reading is from the ninth chapter of Zechariah. The prophet Zechariah was active following the return of exile from Babylon to Jerusalem. The exile returned home, expecting God to restore Israel to its former glory, but they encountered a land devastated and a land in much despair. Yet Zechariah, the prophet, proclaimed that the day would come in Egypt when they would shout aloud for joy, because a new ruler will come and establish God's kingdom of peace, and Israel will be restored. And this ruler will come in humility and will be very different from those who have gone before. Those who are prisoners of hope and those who cannot let go of God and his promise shall see God fulfill his promise. The second lesson is from Romans 7, verses 15 to 25. And it is a lesson that touches all of us. If we were to plead guilt, I think all of us would have to plead guilty. And the lesson is essentially about this. We hear Paul and his description of the war that is within ourselves. Paul says that he just doesn't understand himself. He knows what he wants to do, what is right, and yet he doesn't do it. And he ends up doing the very thing he does not want to do. And while the religious law shows what is right, the great discrepancy between that and what he actually does, the law doesn't help him. And as Lutherans, we all know that the law does not save. It is the gospel to save. If anything, the law makes it worse. Instead of freeing him to be what he should, it only makes him feel more wretched. And because we can identify with Paul, and thus we all need to hear what he has to say. What he has to say is that only the grace of God can free us to be what we should be under the authority of Paul. The gospel comes from St. Matthew, 11th chapter. The generation whom Jesus addressed were like children were never satisfied, and they sought, they counted, because others won't play the game that they want. John the Baptist, you will recall, was criticized because he was an ascetic who refused certain foods and wine. Jesus was criticized because he did just the opposite. Moreover, many considered themselves wise, but in fact, they were blind to what God was doing for Jesus. And the wise ones, the teachers of the law, had made religion into a deadening burden of laws and obligations. So that when it came to what should be done, what should have been a life-giving relationship with God, it was actually a burden. Some of you will remember the 610 rules and regulations that people were expected to follow every day. But Jesus invited the people to come to him and set down the burden that religion had become, and to be refreshed, and put aside the guilt, yoke themselves to the life-giving way of love, and that they can be what they were created without that burden. That yoke will not change. It will fail. Our lesson. The first lesson is from Zechariah, the ninth chapter. Rejoice, O greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, the daughter of Jerusalem. Lo, your king comes to you, triumphant and victorious is he, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, a foal of a donkey. He will carve the chariot from Ephraim, and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the barrel shall be cut off. And he shall command peace to the nation. His dominion shall be from sea to sea, from river to the ends of the earth. As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will set your promises free from the waterless pit. Return to your stronghold, O prisoners of hope. Today I declare that I will restore you to God. The word of the Lord.
And I see to God.
It is no longer I that do it, but sin that dwells within me. So I find it to be a law that when I want to do what is good, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God and in my inmost self. But I see my members another law at war with the law of my mind and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my mind. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. before we begin, I just want to say I talked with Pastor last night. He regrets not being here. But as he does, he plans ahead, and he wrote the sermon last week that I'm going to be reading to you today. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father, the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
For as long as Pastor Jeff can remember, he's been a fan of Laurel and Hardy, the comedy team of years ago. Does anybody remember them? Dan and Ollie? Ollie was the rotund one who was always making a fool of himself, except he didn't realize just how foolish he was, seeing himself as the master of every situation, though the master of none. Still trying to keep his dignity intact, even when he finally realized how foolish he had been. And Stan, his skinny, hapless, loyal sidekick, who could only scratch his head in befuddlement or cry with helplessness when they found themselves in some mess, and whom Ollie blamed for every disaster that befell him. He saw every movie they ever made, and no matter how often he saw them, he was still laughing. He thinks his favorite Laurel and Hardy movie was the one in which there were piano movers. The movie opens with Stan and Ollie arriving at a home to deliver a piano. The home sits atop a high, steep, terraced hill with 100 or more steps leading up to the door. Ollie looks over his situation, he gets a pained look on his face, and shakes his head, while Stan does the classic double take, shrugs his shoulders, and sighs. Then Ollie's pride and determination take over, and he says, "Well, what are you waiting for, Stanley?" As if there will be nothing to it. Ollie points for Stan to get at the other end of the piano, while he grabs the front end, and then he jerks his head toward the steps to say, "Let's go." And at the steps, they begin to trudge. After much pushing and pulling and hauling and groaning, they make it to the first landing on the terraced hill. Exhausted, Ollie announces that they will rest there for a minute, and of course, Stan immediately lets go of the piano before it's secured on the landing, and it starts rolling back down the steps. Ollie cries, "Ooh!" And Stan starts to whimper helplessly as they will flutter their bowler hats on their heads, and take off at the piano as it bounces all the way back down to the street. This time, Ollie decides he must take complete charge, since Stan is obviously incompetent. And so as Stan takes his position at the end of the piano, Ollie pokes him in the chest with his finger and says, "Never mind, Stanley, I'll do it. Just hoist the piano on my back, and I'll carry it." Stan scratches his head in befuddlement, then shrugs his shoulders and sighs like a fool, and does what Ollie says. And off they go once more, with Ollie instructing Stan to follow behind him and steady the piano and take some of the weight off. Stan soon discovers, however, that he can let go without Ollie knowing it, and up they climb with Ollie bearing all the weight. They make it past the first landing and nearly to the halfway point, when Ollie steps on a roller skate left on the step. He and the piano both fly up in the air and then go bouncing back down the steps with Stan chasing after them. When Stan reaches the street, Ollie is sitting in a heap, and all he can say is, "Well, this is another fine mess you've gotten me into." Finally, after two or three more attempts, they make it to the top. Ollie, exhausted and yet proud of having done it, rings the doorbell. The lady of the house answers the door, and Ollie politely removes his hat and with a self-satisfied smile motions to the piano and announces, "Your piano, Matt." The woman looks quite surprised and asks, "How did you get it up here?" Ollie answers with a voice that reveals how pleased he is with himself. "Why, up these stairs, of course." And Stan grins and nods his head in agreement. With that, the woman bursts out laughing. When she finally manages to catch her breath, she says, "Why didn't you use the driveway and come in the side door where there are no steps?" And there they stand, all embarrassed and nervously playing with his tie, trying to maintain his dignity, and Stan looking puzzled. is not hanging over. Come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, Jesus says. Come to me, all you who are loyal and hardy, is another way of putting it. And we are, all of us, loyal and hardy. Before all else, it is a tragic word that Jesus speaks. It's a word that speaks the truth of our lives. The truth that we are, all of us, weary and carrying heavy burdens. That we, all of us, labor and are heavy laden. That we, all of us, are loyal and hardy, carrying our lives like some great piano on our backs, struggling under the weight of our lives, pushing and pulling and hauling along the great weight of it all. And of course, only each of us can say for ourselves what it is that so wearies us, what it is that we labor under, what burdens we carry. Perhaps it is our past that so weighs us down, all the foolishness and miserable failures. Or maybe it is guilt or some hidden shame. Or maybe it's the staleness and sameness of things, never anything other than what we've always been. Laurel and Hardy, we all of us are. And as with them, so too with us, it never once dawns on us that there is another way, a far easier way. It's the tragedy of our lives. We keep laboring under the weight of it all, keep trying to carry it all, until at last we are so weary of it all. We go through life as if life is like a long flight of steps, and we figure that if we can just make it to the top, we can finally set the burdens down and find some rest and peace. And what is it at the top of the seemingly endless flight of steps? Maybe success, some ultimate goal. But for most of us, it is God, heaven, the kingdom itself. And so up and up we trudge, trying to do it right, get it right, do it perfectly. Because we figure that's how it really is when all is said and done. It's up to us to get where we want to be, to get ourselves to God, to deliver ourselves, to present ourselves at his doorstep, pointing with pride at what we've done, the load we've carried, that we've made it. Each step is a hazard, a danger. And sure enough, we let our guard down for a moment, and everything goes crashing back down the steps. We trip up and go bouncing back down the steps, only to pick ourselves up with as much dignity as we can, and load ourselves up once more and start the climb all over again. Just like Laurel and Hardy. But unlike Laurel and Hardy, we never quite make it. It was the Apostle Paul who said it best. I do not understand my own actions, for I do not do what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. For I delight in the law of God in my innermost self, but I see in my members another law at war with the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. Wretched man that I am. That is the tragedy, the wretchedness of it. No matter what we do, we just can't bring it off by ourselves, rid ourselves of the load, be anything other than what we've always been. But we sure keep trying, only loading ourselves down all the more. But Jesus also speaks another word, not a tragic word, but the word of high and rich comedy. Come to me, Jesus said, and I will give you rest. Why did you use the driveway? That's the unexpected rich joke of it. There's a far easier way. Come to me and I will refresh you. There's another way of putting it. We can set it all down. The past, the guilts, the shames, the great foolishness and miserable failures, the memories that haunt us, the pain that so embitters us. We can set it down and be refreshed. All of it. Right now. Come to me, Jesus said. Now, he didn't say, come to religion, or come to doctrine, or come to the Ten Commandments, because religion and doctrine and all the rules are a great part of the burden we carry, what weighs us down so. What Jesus said was that we were to come to him, We're to come to him however we are, in whatever way we can, with our tattered pride and threadbare dignity hanging on us like an old coat, something like how Laurel and Hardy would have finally come to him. There's another way. No long climb, no endless steps, no carrying our lives like a piano on our back. Come to me, take my yoke upon you, and learn from me, Jesus said. And that is how it begins, by putting down our yokes and all that we have been hauling and straining under our whole lives through, and learn from him. Learn not what has become petrified in doctrine and codified in the list of rules and organized into this structure or that, but learn his gentleness and mercy and graciousness, and allow that to fill us. To learn such things is to at last find rest for our weary spirits, rest from all the laboring and straining, and to be refreshed like we are refreshed on the porch of a mountain cabin, or on the beach at the ocean. The refreshment we feel when at last we let it all go for a moment and allow the beauty of the mountains, or the sun and sea to fill us, and it's like a heavy weight is lifted from us. And we are to take his yoke upon us and learn that it fits, that it's not a burden at all, because we are to yoke ourselves to him and learn gentleness and mercy and graciousness ourselves. And then to follow him into the world and work for him, take risks for him, pray for miracles, work for peace, be fooled for his sake, even be him to others. And thus know our refreshment at last and have a spirit that is truly free to live and to love. And now once again today we do come unto him. We come unto him in communion. And like Laurel and Hardy we come, still laboring and heavy laden. Let us finally set it all down and be refreshed so that we can rise up with great laughter in our hearts.
And now, let's affirm our faith in the words of the Apostle Paul. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of the Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered upon the Spirit, was crucified and died in the Spirit. He descended into heaven. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of the saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. O Lord, our God, from the sprawling opulence of the soft red earth and lazy sky, to the lonely beauty of the meeting with its prim certainty of neat white houses and stone fences, to the sweet of the Middle West, whose little towns set amidst vast and rich prairies, to the majestic mountains of the West, and the brash glitter of the rolling coast, this proud nation stretches, awesome and free. And we give you thanks, O Lord. We thank you for all the blessings that you have bestowed upon this land. We thank you for those who struggled to establish our freedom, and to those who sacrificed to preserve it, and to those who continue to hold before us the version of what we should be. We thank you for delivering us out of our follies to this day, and gracing us with new hope and possibilities. And we pray that you will continue to grace us with the faith and the courage to find solutions to the problems that so challenge and threaten us, to make justice and opportunities available to all, to bring peace to our streets and world, to protect the beauty of the land, and be a beacon of light hope to all people. And give us the eyes, O Lord, to see the gifts that are there in each day. Help us to give you thanks and to be open to the oneness of each day, to accept love, to receive friendship, and to offer friendship. And if we are struggling, O Lord, with the depression or anxiety, and if we are frustrated and just don't know what to do, the work is gone sour and our relationships gone bad, help us to lift up our hearts to you and trust your love for us, and trust that you will guide us and help us find a way and give us strength we need. And we pray, O Lord, for those who are ill and are hospitalized, for those who are suffering and hurt, for those who are dying, for those who are grieving. Be with them, heal them, raise them unto hope and life. Especially do we pray for those battling the coronavirus and to those who mourn the loss of someone with the virus. And we pray too for Wanda Thompson, Brad Turner, Barbara Hedrick, Heather Glenn, Michelle Bryan, Harold Penny, Linda Kaiser, Martha Raskin, Kay Newman, Annette Flanigan, Ronald Jones, Bill Dixon, George Pringle, Carl Reckerman, Linda Clinton, Sarah Fields, Christy Gordon, and Roberta McCool. And for all those family and friends so dear to us. And help us, O Lord, to remember the unemployed, those struggling financially, and the lonely and the outcast and rejected, the hungry and the homeless and the refugees of this world. Let us be a friend to them. Let us be Christ to them. And peace, O Lord, peace on this earth. Let us seek it, risk it, establish it. And now, in the silence, O Lord, we pray our most personal prayers and listen for the word and speak to us. O Lord, as we come to your table, let us come unto you and be refreshed. Feed and nourish us with that love and joy and praise, and be people who feed and nourish others. Grace our days with laughter, and grant us the faith that trust what all shall be and all will be well.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and all places offer thanks and praise to you, Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join you in their unending hymn.
Power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Thank you.
peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.